hotel. Over the other side, I think I'd get a better shot from over the other side there.
Thank you. Melbourne.
Still won. Good job. Great job.
Now that helps. They're back.
Thank you.
Oh. Oh.
Here comes the stampede. Okay. Maybe I'm wrong.
I was kind of like an 8 minute miler kind of guy. And it was right around this time of 42 to 45, I was kind of always in the middle of like the thick of it.
The hair becomes a bunch.
I didn't pull off the garbage bag and look at
it. Good job.
As what it could be.
Funny to see the various facial expressions. Oh, yeah.
Well, what was the famous joke by Rodney Dangerfield? He said, you know, my doctor said I should start running all the years of my life. He said, he's right. He says, I just ran 5 miles and I feel 20 years old already.
Rodney.
I saw him once. Well, I lived here in Cleveland 30 years ago. And I saw him here when he was when it was, I guess it was middle, late 80s, when he had hit his kind of that new plateau, it was like after he'd done some of the movies and stuff. And he was hilarious. And there was these three guys in the front row.
It was a club downtown.
It was something I can't even remember. Yeah, I almost think that I seem to remember Mike that it was in. I don't know if it was, it feels to me like it was in the rail.
Oh, there was. There was a place called, it was off of Wilson Mills Road. It was called.
Then that's where it was.
Right off of the 271. Okay.
Yeah.
In the round.
Yeah.
Rodney.
Oh. And there was these three guys in the front row that were dressed like in white shirt, red tie, and black suit. And he would go, you know, let me tell you, you know, of course that's the thing. And they'd jump up and they'd go, you tell us, Rodney, you know. And it was like, it's like they were hecklers, but not hecklers, you know. And it was funny. There's clearly a guy who had seen it all through his career. And it took a little while to how to get the interplay with these guys because they were fanboys to the ultimate, but kind of disrupting the cadence a little bit, you know.
How awesome.
Yeah.
That's great.
Peter. I
that was Peter. Yeah, that was Peter.
Like Caddyshack was his first movie. Role.
Yes.
He was
yes.
kind of a late bloomer to the movies.
Right.
Put a big deal on Johnny Carson and all.
Oh yeah. If you've ever want to really entertain yourself, there is a couple of they're documentaries, I guess. But it's the backstory of both Caddyshack and Animal House. And the Caddyshack one with Rodney, I remember that because he said that it was his first movie role. And Harold Ramis and Chris Kenny, the guy from Gilmore, you know, they were the first time director, first time producer. And so, Caddyshack. So they had obviously written or co-written, Animal House, but they jumped. So they didn't know what they were doing. And so Harold Ramis tells the story. He says, well, Rodney Dangerfield, right? Because I mean, this guy's jokes were one-liners. They were tight. There wasn't a wasted word. Nothing. He says. So he comes in. He says, "Hey boys, you mind if I massage my lines a little bit?" You know. And he said, they go, no. They all think, "Hey Lang, this is it." He goes, "We had these bits," he goes, "but he reduced them by 75%, just like, hey, you should get a bowl of soup when you wear this hat." You know, all that shit that was
awesome. As he's strolling to the dance floor.
Exactly, yeah. Hey, you must have been great before electricity and all. Yeah. Wang, don't tell him you're Jewish, it's a restricted club. Yeah. And it's really, really, really funny. And they said that the studio had like a SWAT team all lined up of an experienced director, experienced producer. They were all set to just take the movie away from him. And that's what I guess John Peters, you know, he's the famous producer, who said, when they signed Rodney, they thought it was a good idea, but he hadn't acted. And he says in this thing, he says, he came into my office, he kicks out a vial around his neck, puts a line of coke on the table, does it, and says, okay, so what's my part or something? He said, it was built for, you know, and they had, everybody was young, remember, they had all those young kids, so they're just, everybody's going crazy.
Magical confluence of personalities.
And they found this golf club, I guess, that was about to be, you know, torn to smithereens and redeveloped. So that's how they could do the explosions and all that shit, you know.
That's cool. I'd love to see it.
I'm sure you can get it on YouTube. It's very fun.
Well, you bump into the movie all the time. And when we were down in Dallas this past weekend for our son's graduation, we had the, you know, VRBO was staying there, the whole family's there. And in between all the fun, we were just tail surfing. There's Caddyshack.
Cheap Gazunas, baby!
We stumbled in on Caddyshack. It was just like the kids, you know, they heard of it and saw a little bit. It was like, they all came to the conclusion that You guys had so much more fun before the internet.
Exactly.
Like, yeah, we did, actually.
Exactly. That's why I was like, it was a few months ago, my son, Sean, he's 16, almost 17. And I was talking about Caddyshack, or it could have been Caddyshack or Animal House. It's like, I haven't seen it. I was like, stop what you're doing right now. We're watching this.
This is mandatory.
Exactly.
Mandatory.
You're not a full American male unless you both.
You guys finish all right? You
yes.
Shower, yeah. And then you're on your chair, everybody. Yeah.
How you doing, brother?
You close it down last night?
No. I did the
electric slide.
Yeah.
So I was at the beginning of the race. There's a soldier, full gear, 80-pound pack, with a pair of flags. So he's got to
be coming soon.
Yeah.
80-pound pack.
That away, J.O. Yeah, baby. Wow. That away, Brian.
Look at this guy. Everybody.
The Team Gazoonist just finished.
Oh, did they?
Yeah.
Okay, nice. So, I don't know, did you see Kim Wood? Did she finish?
I did not see Kim.
All right, so Kim was like, I can't lose to Chad again this year. So both Chad and the boys?
He and Ivy came across together.
Ivy ran. Huh?
Yeah. Look at this guy.
Yeah, the most kick, right?
Yeah.
By the way, big man, where are your skates? Huh?
That's a good song.
By the way, Howard.
Yeah, the guy in JC said that the soldiers didn't last year.
Yeah. Oh, really? Probably enjoying the rain.
Right.
Another wave coming. You see the break 50 minutes.
Oh, yeah. So, Mike, I had a buddy, you said you ran the marathon. So I had a buddy that was running New York, you know, and it was his first time, and he's telling the story after the fact. And he said, I guess, you know, there's all sorts of groups in there, and they hold up signs. You know, we're finishing 5 hours, 3.5, 3:45, all this. So he can run with us, you know. And he's like, oh, 4 hours. Yeah. And he says he gets out there, and he said, like a lot of people, I'm sure, it's like, I'm doing really well, and you know, you go through the ebbs and the flows, he said, and I'm, you know, coming down the last mile or whatever, and I'm dying. And I recognize the 4 hours passing by.
How do I, David? Yeah.
He said, I finished like 4:03. He goes, I don't even have the sign up, because it was just such a disgrace that I could have run with those guys. They all made it 3:52 or whatever. I'm 10 seconds behind. Something like that, 3 and 2 or something along that line. And he's set. I can't remember the time and everything he does, but I stayed on that three. I stayed on that sequencing, and it was the only. He said in the end, it was the only thing that saved me. Because in many different intervals, I was like, I'm feeling golden. I can keep going. I'm not just walking when I need to.
I only did one marathon.
How many?
It's very competitive. It's all physical too, but very mental. Like, okay, how am I going to get
60 roughly?
Yeah. For me, it's like, you know, I typically went like here, I'd be like an 8-minute pace. But for that, I was like 9. I didn't finish this thing. Right, like 9. Okay, I'm gonna run my 10K, which I've done a lot of, and then run a marathon. Yeah. Train for it. And then after that, every mile is gonna be a bowl of going. So here's a bowl number one of my turns, lane number two.
Right.
Now we're at the turn, mentally, just kind of, because it's 5 hours of this for me, drudgery.
Right.
And, the bummer for that is that I finished it like 5:02. Like, I could have, there was a little green on the floor. I could have maybe made that push sub 5.
Well, when I lived in New York, for a few years, I lived at the 17 mile marker. It was right off the First Avenue. Say another coming off the green. So, obviously, there's 8 stations all over the way, but 17. There were some people, and some extremely deep distress. We're sitting in my apartment having Bloody Marys and shit, you know. So when they were watching TV, they said, oh, they're coming off the Greensboro, so we walk up.
We're probably getting there.
The thing that stunned me, I've told this story 100 times, is the leaders come out. I mean, somebody's like, well, how do you think they finish? I go, I know, but when you see it on TV, I don't fully get the pace. You know, I was stunned. And, you know, they're moving a little bit. Just really something. But New York, that was the best I ever saw in New York, meaning the city. I mean, just the vibe.
First week of November.
Yeah, the vibe. There's Caroline! Just the vibe in the town is so positive. It's just a great, great energy day. How about your younger son? What's he up to? Your middle son.
Ben just graduated SMU. ABC, Alex, Ben, Charlie.
Okay.
So Charlie's our youngest. And he just finished up his freshman campaign at University of Miami.
Oh, okay.
Striking that balance between academia and all the other types of stuff. But you get a little recalibration there.
We're trying to figure that out with Charlie. He's a junior going into senior year, you know, and high school. Just think about him on his own. You know, the one thing is he and her eye, they're very close to me. So they got a car to share. And so the way we did it so we put up a couple of grand, and they each had to put up and then for the monthly notice is about $300, $200. We pay $100 and those two after the other $5. You know, and Sean is very diligent about that car. He gets very uptight.
But it's like Cleveland, like it doesn't actually get that hot, you know? My buddy lives in
town. And I said to Chris, I said,
just the other day I said, you know, he's going to State View here, there's no doubt in my mind, because I wouldn't trust spending money for him elsewhere, at least not to start. And I think what we're going to do with this thing is, look, you know, you go to Ohio State or whatever, I said, I'll pay for room and board. And if you get a free 3-0, I'll pay off your note at the end of every semester.
Yeah.
And once you get,
yeah.
I'm not going to tell them, if you get one semester on this belt, then I'll just pick it up entirely, yeah. You know. But, you know, because it takes real pride. I was like, he works, so he's got to deal. So he says, I forget where we're going to go. I forget where it's like a day trip or weekend trip. And he's going to cost, say, $400. And he says, I can't pay for this. He goes, I mean, I don't want to, but I can pay for it. Now you know how I feel. I mean,
Dad, mom and dad could be.
Yeah, exactly. So what he says to me, he's like, Dad, I had to get the oil changed, I had to fill up for the gas, this, you know, and I go, look, I said, I'll buy you money for $40 for the oil change. No, I'm taking care of that car. Taking care of that car. I'm like, all right, good for you, bro. That's good for you. So maybe that'll be the secret to get his ass out of bed every morning. Because that's what I said to him. I go, I can't get your ass out of bed when I'm sitting there screaming over top of you each morning. I was like, let alone send you, you know, a couple hundred miles away and hoping you're going to get up and go to class.
Okay, gotcha.
You know.
Yeah, I am. I'm a fleet manager for our cars and kit. You know, Texas right now all things up here, so we got four vehicles and five drivers, so we do a whole lot of horse trading.
Right.
The irony is fleet manager. Here we go, 1 hour threshold.
Got a cup of cross.
Bought it. Call 59.
Yeah.
We got water. Stop.
There you go, big man.
Thank you.
Thunder right after you guys. Good job, sir. It's like the most technical spot to be.
Ready to go. Good job, good job.
Oh, there's a big man. Let's go, baby. Oh, So I'm an Italian food.
Yeah.
I'm a seafood.
Oh, nice.
I really like try.
Yeah,
his older brother, but he just kept running.
Enjoy your week.
Right.
welcome. Enjoy your weekend.
Guy you said, right? Yeah, how'd you do?